Okay. Nobody's joined the computer yet. That's okay, because there's three of y'all here. So, I guess we'll start over here. Anna, what questions do you have?
Number 10 on chapter 4.
10. Pulley problem, and it's probably the pulley that's messing you up, right? Maybe.
There's two ropes, or two pulleys.
Yeah. Okay. So let's go through this one. This is there are no red numbers. So everybody's got the same numbers. In fact, there are no numbers at all. You've got mass one and mass two and two pulleys. And it asks a whole bunch of questions. What are all these accelerations? And what are the two tensions? Okay. So let me draw a picture. So question is, what are all these masses and tensions? In general, remember how we do these problems?
Different forces.
On what?
On each mass.
Yeah. So we've got two objects, this object and this object. The pulleys are massless, the ropes are massless, and there's no friction, which is not reality. But that's complicated, so we'll get to that later. So in general, we're asked for two accelerations and two tensions. So we're gonna need some equations to wrestle with this. And so the way we do this is we do some of the forces on this mass and some of the forces on this mass. And then we're going to need something else because we've got more unknowns than just two equations. But let's do that first. So starting with this one, what are the forces on this mass?
The force of gravity.
Okay.
And then the force of tension.
Yep. That's tension number one. So doing some of the forces on this one, we have tension, which is positive, and gravity, which is negative, and that equals m1 times a1. In which way is this one going to accelerate?
Yeah.
This one's going to go down, so this needs a negative sign because that acceleration is negative. That little negative sign there is a pesky little one. It's easily forgotten. So when you're writing this out, make sure you realize which way is this one going to go and insert your negative or not, depending on which way it goes. Does that make sense? Where did this piece come from?
That's the force of gravity.
Yeah. This is mg is the force of gravity. And why is it negative?
That's
funny. Okay, good. So we've got this nice equation here. And I'm looking at this, and I'm seeing tension, don't know that. Acceleration, one, I don't know that. Two unknowns, one equation, so we're gonna need at least another equation, so where should we go?
2 plus 2.
So we'll go over here, and we'll look at the forces on this one. Now, is there friction with the table?
It's frictionless.
The table is frictionless too? Yeah. Okay. So, which way is this one going to accelerate?
Would it accelerate?
Yes.
Okay, to the right?
Yeah, it's going to go to the right. And this is the hard part. So as this thing is going down, it's attached to the pulley directly. And this pulley is free to spin here, but that pulley is moving that way. And as that pulley moves, this rope is attached to the wall at this end. It's not moving. But this end is attached to that mass, and that can slide somewhere. So as the pulley goes this way, that's also going to go this way, but not at the same rate as the pulley. Does that make sense?
Okay. So.
Doesn't make sense, does it?
No, it doesn't.
I appreciate honesty.
I think, like, if it pulled this way, wouldn't, like, it. Because, like.
Yep.
I don't.
Let me get a pulley. It helped. This is one of those ones that's really hard to visualize with a thing on the board. Let me get a real pulley and show you.
Okay.
So just give me 1 minute and my keys. There. I'll be right back. Sounds like somebody just joined. Hello, hi Hunter.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going well. I'm running behind, sorry.
No, you're good.
I was in Columbia for a conference and it ran over and...
Oh, that's no worries.
So, we're looking at, oh, this would be better. We're looking at number 10 in homework 4.
Alright.
And is this pulley problem? And we're discussing, how does this pulley work here? What's going on with that? So
okay.
I'm trying to recreate it here. Got a nice set of pulleys here, but they're all, it's all You know, it's a set of pulleys for general purposes, not for this particular problem. Yeah, I could use about two more hands here. Hold this for a minute. So this is going to go in here. Now that goes there. So this setup here is just like that one, except it's sideways because I'm using gravity. Okay, so y'all see how it's the same setup as that one? Okay, on this picture, this one's going that way. And this one is that one. Okay, does that kind of make sense? See how the pulley, how the string is attached to something solid, like this string is attached to the wall? Okay. And I want you to notice that, let's see, I'm going to start this mass, let's see, I'll start it right down here. So this hook is right here, 55, okay? And I'll put my finger up here at 5, okay? So now watch how far my finger goes. You go to 45. So my finger went from 5 to 45, okay? 40 centimeters. And the mass here went from 55 35. How far did my fingers go? 40 centimeters. How far did the mass go? From 55 to 35. 20 centimeters. Does that make sense? So my point is, because of the way this pulley is set up here, however far this hand goes, this one goes half the distance. It also works with speed. However fast this hand goes, this one goes half the speed. It also works with acceleration. However fast this hand accelerates, this one accelerates half the acceleration. Okay?
What does that lead to? Is that like why is it halfway?
It's because this side of the rope doesn't move.
Okay.
And so the pulley, this rope goes this speed. This rope doesn't move at all. So the pulley does halfway in between. Okay? And really, you're right. Just looking at the picture, that's hard to see. But once you see it happen, that helps a lot. Okay? So, somebody else is joining here. So, anyway, hey Clay, sorry I'm running late today. I was in Columbia at a conference. Anyway, we're working on problem number 4 here.
Problem 7.
Problem 10, chapter 4. And we just figured out an important relationship here. And that relationship is that the acceleration of 2 is going to relate to the acceleration of 1. How? It's going to be half. Does that make sense to everybody? Acceleration 2 is going to be half of acceleration 1. And Clay, you just missed it. We figured that out because we had the pulley system in here. I just showed you. You can watch the rerun later. Okay, so does that make sense to everybody? Okay. Okay, so now let's apply forces to this mass up here. What are the forces on this mass?
Yep, we've got normal force pulling it up.
Gravity pulling it down. T2 pulling it that way. Notice T1 doesn't pull this. T1 pulls the pulley. The pulley pulls this, but that's a different story. Does that make sense? Okay. So we've got this up force and this y force. So you're looking at this and you're saying, oh no, I'm going to have to break this into the x, some of the forces x and some of the forces y. And technically, you're right, you should. But you don't need to do it in the y direction. These two don't matter. The only thing that's going to accelerate that way, right? So we really are only concerned with the x direction. Okay. So let me get rid of these magnets here. So for this one, we're going to do sum of the forces is equal to mass times acceleration. And on this one, the only force in the x direction is T2. And the mass is M2. And its acceleration is A2. So there's this T2, there's this A2. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 unknowns. And we've got 1, 2 equations. Look at this. Third equation. Well, that's what we're going to do eventually. But we've got 4 unknowns and 3 equations, and the rules of algebra say however many unknowns you have, that's how many equations you've got to have, right? So if we've got 4 unknowns and 3 equations, we need one more equation, right? So we're going to get that one. And I think the hint is in the problem, actually. Oh, wait, no, it's not. Yes. The fourth equation is going to come from a fourth object, I mean a third object. Let's do some of the forces on this pulley. Okay? So what are the forces on this pulley? T2 pulls this way on the pulley and this way on the pulley. Remember, ropes always pull in both directions. Okay, so if Ann and I were to have a tug of war, the rope would pull me this way and it would pull her this way. So this rope right here pulls the mass this way and the pulley this way. Furthermore, that same rope pulls the wall this way and the pulley this way. So there's two ropes attached to that pulley. Both of them are pulling.
But the T2s on the bottom, they cancel each other out.
If they were on the same object, they would. But this T2 is on that pulley, and this T2 is on that mass. So it's always on two different masses. Does that make sense? So we're going to do the sum of the forces thing one more time. Sum of the forces is equal to mass times acceleration. Now we're talking about the pulley. So we've got T1 pulling it to the right, and a T2 pulling it to the left, and another T2 also pulling it to the left.
Can we subtract those?
Yes, thank you. I'm glad you noticed that.
Okay,
And this is going to be equal to mass times acceleration. Now, what's the mass of this pulley? It says it's connected to a very light pulley, P2. What does very light mean? It means it's massless. Does massless exist? No, of course not. But for the simplicity of making a problem that is doable, you know, at entry level where y'all are, this is a massless pulley. We'll introduce masses to pulleys in a few chapters. Does that kind of make sense? So, does it have acceleration? Yes. Does it have mass? No. So, this side, zero. Not because acceleration is zero, but because the mass is zero. Okay, so now we have four equations and four unknowns. And now we can solve this. Okay, so figuring out those four equations is the trick. The trickiest of those tricks was this equation. But now that you see that one, hopefully you'll be able to recognize it next time. And this one is also a little bit tricky because the pulley doesn't have mass, and you're used to just applying Newton's second law to pull to the regular masses, but it works everywhere. Okay. So what this tells us here, I'm going to do a little bit of math, a little bit of algebra here. This is T1 minus 2 times 2t. I'm sorry, T2. And that equals 0. And now I can add this piece to the other side. So we're going to do plus 2t2 plus 2t2. And so this is going to say T1 is equal to 2t2. So that would make, that one becomes a little bit easier to deal with. So now how do you solve this system of four equations? The process is the same as always. Yeah, go ahead.
No, we did T1, we solved, like, so we have like a T1, that's 2t2, and T1.
Mm-hmm.
So what do we do?
So the method is the same as always. Solve one of these equations for something and plug it into another equation. And so that's what we're going to do. Let's take, since this one's already solved for T1, let's just take it and plug that in here. And then you solved this one for T1?
Yeah, I did that earlier.
That's okay. You can do that. Now you can just set this equal to this.
Okay.
That'll be the same thing.
No, not that.
Okay, so I'm gonna take, well, let's see, let's just write that out. So we're using this one and this one right now, in this first step. So the math here says this becomes, instead of T1, I'm going to write 2T2 is equal to, I'm sorry, minus M1G equals negative M1A1. Okay, now we've used two equations to get that. We've used this equation and this equation. And now we need to use the other two somehow. We can do this a couple different ways. How about we take, solve this one for A1, plug it in, and this one's already solved for T2, so we'll plug that in there. Okay? So I'm going to take this and plug it in here. And I'm going to rearrange this one, solve it for A1. So I'm going to get, multiply both sides by 2. And that'll tell me equal to 2A2. And we'll plug this in. There. So now we can rewrite all this. So instead of having 2T2, I'm going to have 2 times this M2A2 minus M1G equals negative M1 times A1, and for that I'm going to write 2A2. And now by doing all those substitutions, we've used every single equation that we have, and the order I did it is not magical. You could have done it in a different order if you wanted to. The only rule is you got to use all four of your equations, okay? And notice what I've got now. I've got one equation with one unknown. We can solve that one unknown. So the way we solve this is we gather like terms. So there's an A2 here and an A2 here. So how about I add this whole piece together? How about I subtract this whole piece to this side? Okay, so I'm going to subtract minus 2m2a2 from both sides. Okay, so that'll, this minus that will be 0. And so I'll be left with negative m1g is negative m1 2 times a2 minus 2m2a2. And now with these, I can pull that A2 out. So I'm going to have A2 times negative 2M1 minus 2M2, and my left side stays the same. And now I can just divide both sides by that parentheses. Negative 2m1 minus 2m2 divided on both sides, 2m1 minus 2m2. This will cancel out, this will cancel out, and that'll tell me A2. And once I have A2, then everything falls into place. Because once you have A2, you can then plug that in there and it'll give you A1. You can plug it in here and that'll give you T2. Once you have T2, you can plug that in there and it'll give you T1, and that's everything. Yeah. And as if that wasn't bad enough, the problem wants you to do it in without numbers. So it just wants equations for everything. So you just this is a nice equation. We can simplify that a little bit. So let me take that and simplify it just a smidge. Notice what we can simplify. I can pull a negative sign and a 2 out of both of these. Pull that up front. So I'll carry that up here. So A2 is equal to negative M1G divided by 2, negative 2, M1 plus M2. See how I pulled that negative 2 out of both of these terms? And then you notice, oh, that negative sign cancels out, doesn't it? So now you can finally write the final equation. A2 equals M1 times G divided by 2, M1 plus M2. Okay. Hunter, what do you think? How's that?
That's good. I get that.
Okay. Clay, how you doing? Clay gives me the silent thumbs up. That works?
Yeah. It's thundering pretty loud over here, so I'm keeping it muted.
That's fine. I appreciate that.
No problem. Doing good. Just kind of following along. Okay. Doing work.
Anna? What are your thoughts?
I'm just having a hard time putting it in.
Yeah.
To WebAssign for it to...
Getting WebAssign to like it is a bit of a trick.
Yeah.
So, let's see. We've got A2 here. WebAssign has a different answer for A2, so it looks like I made a mistake. Which one did we say was A1? We said A1 was this one, right? Start this at 55. And I'm going to start my hand at 5. Okay. So my hand goes to 45. This one went. I think we wrote the first equation wrong. Let's see. D2 equals half of D1, right? D2 equals half of D1. So A2 should be half of A1. WebAssign is saying the exact opposite. WebAssign is saying A2 equals 2A1. So either they got their A's flipped, or they just plain got it wrong. So that's probably why you're not being able to plug it in. Let me look at it. And then I'm not on recording, and I'll put an answer. I'll either email an answer or I'll make another video for it. But there's something's awry here, and I think there's an error on WebAssign. But I'll figure it out later.
Thanks. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now you have to remind me how to say your name again. Is it Jaina?
Mm-hmm.
I said it right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, good. Okay. Jaina, what questions do you have? Where do you start? Is that what you said? Okay, sounds good. Chapter 3, homework 1. No. I said it wrong. What did you say?
Chapter 3, number 1.
Okay, chapter 3, problem 1. The one with the hiker?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Jenny, can you read the problem to me so I'll write it down as we go?
The hiker starts at his camp and moves the following distance while exploring his surroundings, 74 and north.
Okay. Meters, okay, so 74
meters north.
Oops. 74 meters, okay.
And then 2.90 times 10 to the 2 meters east, so 290.
It says 290. Yep. Okay, so 290 east meters. Okay.
115 at an angle of 30 degrees north of east.
North of east. Okay, so here's east. We're going 30 degrees?
Mm-hmm.
30 degrees north of east, so it's going to be up here. How far is this one?
115.
115, which is not as long as that one, so half of that. Okay, so. 115. It is 30 degrees?
Mm-hmm. And then 150 south.
And then 150 meters straight south. Okay? And so it wants, let's see, it wants a couple different questions. First, it wants the magnitude and the direction. And then it asks a second question. We'll hold off on B for just a minute. Let's do the first part first. So, the key to this one is recognizing that this is a vector problem and it's in two dimensions. So, you have to break every crooked vector down into x and y parts. Now, fortunately, this one's straight up and down. You don't have to break it up, it's all up and down. This one's straight side to side. You don't have to break it down, it's all side to side. This one, straight down. We don't have to break it up. But that one, that's the crooked one. So, let's start with that one. Let's break that one down. X and Y. So we've got the X component here and the Y component here. This side is adjacent and this side is hypotenuse, right? So SOHCAHTOA, this would be the CA, right? The cosine. So this side here, we'll use cosine. Let's see, I'll put this aside over here. Cosine of 30 is equal to adjacent, we'll call this x, x over hypotenuse, which is 115. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So we'll multiply 115 on both sides. And so we can find x. And then we'll do the same thing for the y part. Except that this is going to be the opposite side, and that's the hypotenuse. So that would be so, as in SOHCAHTOA, would be the SOH part, right? So this would be sine. So the sine of 30 is opposite, which in this case is y, divided by the hypotenuse, which is still 115. So we're going to multiply both sides by 115. It's going to cancel out there. And that'll tell us why. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay? So, what are these pieces here? Yeah, that sounds right. Okay, good. So now at this point, we've got everything broken down into x and y. So now it's just a matter of adding up all your x's and adding up all your y's. Okay, so I'll do this over here. For my x's, I'm gonna add them all up. I've got 290, and I've got 99.6. And we're gonna add them all up. So this will be 0.6, that'll be a 9, that'll be an 18, 3, 89.6. Okay? And now we'll add up all the y's. For the y's, I've got a 74. Here. And then I've got a 57.5 over there. And lastly, I've got this one, and it's negative. Negative 150. So it's going to be... What is it?
Negative
18.5. Okay. Now, here's what these two numbers do for us. These two numbers tell us that the net distance in the x direction is this, and the net distance in the y direction is this. So it's as if this hiker had hiked straight over 389 and down 18.5. Does that make sense? So, but that's not the answer, that's not what it's looking for. But it gets us almost there. Because it's looking for two things, magnitude and direction. Okay? Neither of these are either of those. However, they are two sides of a right triangle. And our answer is this green arrow that starts at the beginning and ends at the end. So it's if I was a good artist, I would actually look like a triangle. But this is, you know, the adjacent side and the opposite side, and there's your hypotenuse. So to get the hypotenuse, we're going to use Pythagorean theorem. A squared plus B squared equals C squared. So I'm going to call this answer R for resultant. You can call it A for answer if you want, whatever. It doesn't really matter. I'm just calling it something. And so R is going to be equal to 389.6 squared plus 18.5. And really, I should call it negative 18 because it goes down, right? But we're going to square it anyway, so it doesn't matter. And then we're going to take square root of it, because a squared plus b squared equals c squared. And that's the magnitude. Does that make sense? Why is the magnitude just means how much. And the length of that green arrow, that's how much. Now the next question it asks is the direction. And it wants it in degrees south of east. So this red arrow here, that's straight east. So we want to know how many degrees south of east that is. So we're looking for this little bitty angle here. It's not going to be very big. We're looking for that little itty bitty angle there, theta. So to get that, we have this side, we have this side. For that matter, we figured this one out too. So we have all three sides. You can use sine, cosine, or tangent, whatever floats your boat. Let's use tangent. Haven't used it yet. So opposite and adjacent. So tangent of theta is opposite, which is 18.5, divided by adjacent, which is 389.6. And so to get, now to move that tangent over, you have to do arctangent of both sides. So you can't divide by tangent, that's illegal. You gotta do arctangent. So we're gonna do theta is the arctangent, which is a fancy way of saying inverse tangent. 18.5 divided by 389.6. Okay, does that help? So notice something I didn't do. I did not put negative 18. There's a reason for that. Your calculator can handle a negative there, but it's, you have to memorize this little set of rules as to which quadrant you're in, as to what the answer means. I would rather not memorize quadrant things and just look at a picture. So if you just draw the picture like I do, then don't insert positives and negatives. Just say, that's my angle, these are my distances, get your angle. Does that make sense? Okay. Part B asks, would changes in the order in which the hiker makes the given displacements alter his final position? Yeah, so, you know, the beauty of this, or the horribleness of this, depending on how you want to look at it, is you've got five tries and only two options. You will get this one right. But you should really understand why. Does that make sense? So, and the answer is, the hiker went from here to there to there to here. Would it have been the same if the hiker hiked a different route? Like, what if the hiker started here and then did the 150 down? Okay, so the hiker went 150 down, okay? And then maybe this one back up, 74 back up. And then maybe the triangle, the little angle piece over here. And then, and now this last piece, 290 over there.
Would the angle still be the same? Or just the magnitude and the
distance? The angle 30 would still be the same. Yeah, so the end result is, I'm not a very good artist, but if I was a good artist, that point would have ended up at the same spot. So the point is, yeah, the order doesn't matter. You can do it in any order you want. We're just adding vectors. And really the math tells that to you because you can add these in any order you want, you still get the same answer. Okay. And so then it says explain, and I think I just did, so. Okay, does that answer your question? Okay. Hunter and Clay, yell out if you have a question. Y'all doing all right?
I'm good.
Okay. Ansley?
I'm good.
Good? Okay.
Is he
good? Yeah, he's fine. Do you have a question now, Ansley? I think it's your turn now.
And it's on the labs.
Okay, good. Which lab is it?
To the first lab.
Okay, lab one. This is the math lab.
Yes,
okay.
The number five, I wasn't really sure what it was really talking about. It just said simplify the following.
Right, okay. Can I see the lab? Okay, which one, number five? So we're doing number five from lab one. And it says simplify it. So let's look at 5A. We've got A to the power of B times A to the power of C. Now, let me do this with numbers, and it'll make a lot more sense, okay? What if I had a to the power of 5 times a to the power of 3? What does this a to the power of 5 mean? Yeah, but what does that mean, to the fifth power? Exactly. It's A times A times A times A times A, like five times, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's A times A times A times A, that's four of them, times one more, that's five of them, that's this piece, right? And then we're multiplying it by this one, which is what? A times A times A, three times, right?
So would the answer be A to the B plus A?
Exactly. Because this would be a to the 8th, right?
Yeah.
Which is 5 plus 3. Yeah. So then what is this?
Add exponents.
Add exponents. Does that make sense? Okay. The next one is a to the power of b to the power of c. So a to the power of b to the power of c. So let's do the same thing with numbers again. So we're going to do a to, let's pick smaller numbers so I don't have to write it so many times. A to the power of 3 to the power of 2. Okay, so this would be, what is that? Yeah, so this is a times a times a, right? That's this one. And now we square that, right? Which means multiply it times itself again, right? So this is b a times a times a times a times a times a, which is the same thing as a to the 6th. Which is a to the power of b times c. Does that kind of make sense? Part c, is that what you said? Okay, so what do you think about that one? Now that you know part b, how do you do part c? Yeah, because that isn't that what this is? A to the power of b times c? And so this would just be 5 to the power of 1/3 times 3. And what's the third times 3? And so what's 5 to the first power? There you go. Does that make sense? Did you have another question on this one? That was kind of good. Number 13. Okay. This is a triangle problem. It says label all these angles and sides that aren't already labeled on the picture. Okay, so it tells you it's a right triangle. Gives you two sides, 2 and 6. Okay, so this is a right triangle. What does that mean? Yeah, this angle is 90. And whenever you see 90, you know all kinds of stuff. The first thing you know is that SOHCAHTOA works. The second thing you know is that Pythagorean theorem, you know, the a squared plus b squared equals c squared, that also works. So that's how you're going to start this problem with those two tricks in mind. So you see a squared plus b squared. That's going to tell me c squared. And then, once you know all three sides, then you can get your other two angles. You can use, if we call this one theta, do you want me to do that first part out? I just wave my hands and use my mouth.
That one we did is 6.32.
This side?
Yeah. I just got really, really tough numbers for angles. So we thought it might be.
It might be. Let's double check it. Okay, so using this angle as our theta, so that the tangent of theta is opposite, which is 2, over adjacent, which is 6. So theta would be the arctangent of a third. And is your calculator in degrees or radians? Okay, good.
18.
Is that what you got last time? Okay. Do you know what you did wrong last time?
I didn't do the negative.
Yeah, you are up here, but you didn't. You got to move the tangent over. But now you know why, right? Good. And then what about this other angle? How are we going to get that one? You've got two methods now, right?
Six over six.
Sure, you want to do these two sides? Let's give this one angle a different name. How about phi? I'll call this one phi. That one's theta, so we'll call this one something else. And so, Janus, I said that right. Janus? That'll probably be the last time I ask, but one of these times I'll be the same. Okay. So Janus said 6 over this one, right? So that would be opposite and hypotenuse. Now, why is this one opposite? I thought it was adjacent. I'm throwing a trick question at you. Because a minute ago, it was adjacent when we were talking about theta. But we're doing this angle now, so now it is the opposite of that angle. Does that make sense?
Looking back at that theta one,
this
why
one
would we use, well, just the other angle in general?
Theta?
Why would we use the tangent?
You could, you, we know all three sides, so we could have used any of them. We could have used sine or cosine or tangent.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Okay.
Any of them work. We just, I don't know, I just pulled that one out of there. Jane wants to use these two sides for that one, though. So in relation to that angle, this is the opposite side, and this stays the hypotenuse. So opposite and hypotenuse, that's sine. So we're going to say the sine of phi is opposite of the hypotenuse, 6.32. So phi is the inverse sine or arc sine over 6.32. The other way you can do this, and we've got that one, is all of the angles in a triangle have to add up to 180.
Yeah, so you didn't have
to. Yeah, so there's 90, so that means there's only 90 left. If this one's 18, this is whatever it takes to add up to 90. So that works also. Does that help?
Yeah.
Okay. Hunter, it's your turn. What questions do you have?
This upcoming exam, like, what, do you know the format of it? Or
yeah, it's.
Is it just like a bunch of equations, or is it more
of
like theory stuff?
I picked some questions from WebAssign, and there you go.
All right, sweet.
And you know, the questions in WebAssign come straight out of your textbook. So it's entirely possible you could do every single question in the book and you will have done the test.
All right, so I was just wondering what I needed to go over.
So we did, the first test covers 4 chapters, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I just kind of, I picked some questions from 1 and some questions from 2 and some questions from 3 and some questions from 4.
All right, sweet.
And, so that's all there is to it.
Alright, thank you.
Another question on the test.
Yeah.
You said we could come to you to take it?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me see. I know Anna asked me about this the other day. Her question was, when?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Let me pull up my calendar and look. It's not due until the 27th. On the schedule, you're supposed to do it, as in DO, do it on the 22nd, which is next Friday. Would y'all want to do it on a Monday, you know, after the, or on that Friday, I guess we could.
Pretty much free any day that would work for y'all.
Okay. And I know you said you wanted to do it next week, right?
No, not Friday.
You want to do it Friday? Sticking to the schedule,
yes,
doing it on Friday.
Schedule.
okay.
I can do it.
Anytime after 12? 12 on Friday? Would that work for you, Clay?
Next Friday.
Yeah. Friday, I just put my calendar right. What would that be? Friday the 22nd?
Do I know?
Friday the 22nd? Next Friday?
Yeah, sure. And you said what time do y'all think y'all are doing it?
Friday at noon.
Alright, yeah, I can make that.
Okay. I don't know if you want to. The only rule is the test has to be proctored by either myself or Proctor you. I won't charge you, but Proctor will you. Proctor you will charge you. So, use me, you guys are on my schedule. You can use Proctor, you can do anytime you want. So, Danny, you said that doesn't work for you. So, when does Friday work at all for you? It's due on the 27th. That's what I have on my calendar. It's due as in D-U-E due on the 27th. Would you rather push it to the Monday, Jenny? Would that work for you, Anna?
If she's going to do it Monday, I might come in Monday too. That would give me some better timing.
Okay. Clay says more study time is useful. That gives me a weekend. Oh no! Anna has to work on Monday. When do you work on Monday?
I work till
9 o'clock in the morning. I'm planning on an hour and a half. What I mean is. I scheduled the time constraints on WebAssign as an hour and a half, but I'm really thinking it's an hour. Oh, well, it's not. When do you have class? 9:45 to when?
11:20.
Oh, you do too?
Yeah.
Oh, humbug. When are you done with your work? Three on Monday? Okay, let's do this. I'll send out a one of those doodle polls, and I'll throw out a handful of options, and y'all will pick out a time that works.
We all have to do it at the same time.
Well, it saves me from having to sit there for an hour for you, and an hour for you, and an hour for you, and an hour for you. You see what I'm saying? If we do it all at once, I can sit one hour for everybody. And I'll send out a doodle poll. The time where the most people work, when it works for the most people, that's the time we'll use. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
And then if somebody's left out, it's just the way it goes.
For the paper, that was scanned to you, or
right.
Do you want a medical paper?
Okay, yeah, so the paper that you scanned to me. So if I'm your proctor, you can just hand it to me when you get done. That'll be the easiest way. If you're using ProctorU, yeah, it's just your scratch paper, so you can use printer paper, you can use notebook paper, whatever you want to use. But just the key is either scan it in with a scanner or use Cam Scan, which just your phone, but then that little software makes it nicer for your read. And then just email it to you. And then whenever you are finished with the test, you've got a 15-minute window to send me that. Hey, does that answer your question? To scan, Cam Scan it to me.
Would it be better for us to really study our homework or study our class examples?
I mean, it's similar to all of it. So the question was, is it better to study homework or better to study class examples? And the answer is yes, it's all important. What other questions do y'all have? Hunter and Clay are silent. Test question, homework questions, whatever. Go for it. Anna's got another homework question. Which one is it?
Number 9.
Number 9 from chapter 4? Number 9 from chapter 4. Okay, this is the inclined plane. It's got a steel plane and an aluminum block and a copper block. And the reason it gives you those particular things is because there's a table in the book where you can look up frictions between those different metals. So let's draw a picture. Ansley, this is your. So number 9, you've got a mass of M1, and that's the aluminum block. Okay, let's see about a picture over here. And what are your numbers for that one, Anna?
1.05
for N2, 7.95. 7.95. And it was 33.5. 33.5. Okay. And we're asked for tension and acceleration. Notice this is kind of a trend with these problems, right? You always have to find those two things, tension and acceleration. So, and the method of approach is the same as usual, right? You say, oh, two objects, two unknowns, Newton's second law, once for each, right? So let's do some of the forces. MA on this object here, okay? So what are the forces on it?
Normal force.
Normal force is pushing it up. Gravity's pulling it down. Tension's pulling it to the side. And one more.
Friction.
Friction. Thanks for coming, y'all. Sorry I was late. It was nice to meet you, Clyde. Bye. Okay. So this means we're gonna have to break this down into x and y. We're gonna have to do this. We're gonna do this for x, and we're gonna do it for y. Now, we can look at this and say, well, it's only gonna accelerate this way, right? Why do we need to do these two? You need these two. This one's kind of intuitive. You don't really need to do it, but I'll do it once just so that next time you can say, oh yeah, that's intuitive. This one, you really have to do it, okay? But we'll do it here also, okay? So let's break this up into the x and the y. So sum of the forces x equals mass times acceleration in the x direction. So we're gonna have tension to the right, so that's positive, minus force of friction to the left, that's negative, equals mass 1, it is mass 1, isn't it? Yeah. Mass 1 times acceleration. And notice I'm just writing acceleration because they're attached by the same rope, they're going to accelerate at the same rate. Okay. One more step here. What's the equation for the force of friction? You've got two equations for that, force of friction static and force of friction kinetic. For static, it's less than or equal to normal force times mu. For kinetic, it's just plain equals to normal force times mu. And this one, we can assume this is moving because it asks for acceleration.
Okay.
So because it asks for acceleration, it's moving. So we use kinetic unless it's just plain equal.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So we'll do tension minus normal force times mu equals M1 times A. Okay? Now let's do the y component. So we'll do sum of the forces in the y direction equals mass times acceleration in the y direction. The forces in the y direction normal force, which is up, and force of gravity, which is down. And how fast is it accelerating in the y direction? It's going to go sideways, but it's not going to go up, right? So this is zero. Acceleration is zero. So here's what this does for us. This tells us that the normal force equals the force of gravity. In other words, the normal force is m1 times g. So the only reason to do this is to get that. Does that make sense? So, and we need that here. So this is kind of intuitive, and that is true as long as, as long as it's flat and not accelerating, which is the case here. Now this one, that won't be true, because it's not flat.
So as long as it's not flat.
As long as it's flat and not accelerating, like in an elevator, then this is true. And so that's the intuitive part.
So if it's not accelerating, it's in the y direction.
Correct. Not accelerating in the y direction. So with that said, we can now plug that in there with the tension minus m1g times mu equals m1a. And just plug this in. Okay, now we'll do this one. What are the forces on that block?
The normal force.
Normal force.
The force of gravity.
Force of gravity.
Tension.
Tension.
Friction.
Which way does friction go?
It opposes motion.
It opposes motion, so since this thing is going to accelerate this way, friction's going to go this way. So, because this is on an inclined plane, usually the best way to do these, and really for this class always, the best way to do these is to make yourself a new coordinate system. Fly is so pesty. X, Y. So for the inclined plane, X is parallel to the inclined plane, and Y is perpendicular. And notice what that does for you. Your acceleration is straight in the X direction. This force, straight Y, both of these forces, straight X, you only have one crooked vector now. Whereas if we had the coordinate system flat, all of these would be crooked, and acceleration would be crooked, and that'd be a pain in the neck. So that's why we make it crooked. It's just so that it makes less work for us.
I think what confuses me is how to draw the triangle, like, right.
Yep, yep. This triangle that we're about to draw is the most misdrawn triangle in the world. So you've got two parts. This part here has to be straight in that direction. And most people get that part right. The tricky part is the part that goes here. And the catch is, it's got to be in the x direction, which is parallel to this. Let me draw it the wrong way first. What a lot of students draw it wrong is they'll carry this down here and make this flat. That's wrong, because this is not parallel to the inclined plane. So what you want to do is make it parallel to the inclined plane. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
That's the hard part. If you do that, then this angle and this angle are the same.
Which angles?
This angle up here and this angle over here are the same. So this side here is the opposite side of the triangle. So this is going to be FG sine theta, because because it's opposite, and FG is hypotenuse. And this side here is going to be FG cos theta, because that's the adjacent side. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And you're right. I'm glad you asked about that, because that is number one, by a long shot, the most misdrawn triangle in this class. Okay? So, let's do sum of the forces in the x direction equals mass times acceleration in the x direction, and then we'll have to do the y's also, but let's do the x's first. So in the x direction we have tension, which is in the negative direction, and friction. Also in the negative direction. And this equals, oh wait, we're not done. There's one more force in the x direction. What is that one? This one down here. We can call it force of gravity in the x direction, or you can just call it that, whatever floats your boat. So this is going to be plus Fg sine theta. And this equals mass times acceleration in the x direction. And just, and the acceleration in the x direction is just acceleration. Remember, it's the same value as this one over here. So I'm just going to call it A. Okay. So let's write this out. So this would be m2 times g times sine theta minus tension minus normal force times mu equals m2 times a. I just rearranged it, put the positive term first. And I plugged in the equation for force of friction. And notice, we don't know what n is. And your gut says, ah, m2 times g. But no, that would be wrong, because this is an inclined plane. So we've got to do some of the forces in the y direction just to figure out what the normal force is. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So let's do some of the forces in the y direction equals mass times acceleration in the y direction. And the forces in the y direction are this and this. So we've got normal force that's positive minus mg cos theta. And how fast does it accelerate in the y direction? How fast does this block go that way or this way?
Zero.
Yeah, it doesn't. So this equals zero. And notice what that does for us. That tells us the normal force. The normal force is equal to mg cos theta. And now we can take that and plug this in there. And now we've got our second equation, m2g sine theta minus the tension minus mg cos theta times mu equals m2 times a. Now we finally have two equations, this one and this one, with our two unknowns, tension and acceleration. So now we can do that usual process of solving one of them for one of the unknowns and plug it into the other.
The mg with the cosine theta, that's m2g?
Yes, yes. Thank you for noticing. That's m2. Does that make sense why all that is?
Yes.
Okay, now there's one more piece that we haven't dealt with yet. Well, two more pieces. There's the algebra. But then there's this mu. What is that? Well, you have to look it up in a table in your book. And I don't know, I don't have that table on me. I don't know what it is.
It's actually with the problem.
Oh, is it with the problem?
Yeah,
with the problem. Oh, good. Okay. So this mu, the one that goes with the copper block, what is that one? 3-6. Okay. And this mu, the one that goes with the aluminum block, what is that one?
147.
Okay, but now that we know that, now we can just do algebra. Okay. And if this were a test, getting to the point where you have those two equations, that's the vast majority of your credit. Okay? You want to wrestle with algebra, or are you good with that? Okay, go for it. Think through it for a minute. Let me ask the other guys how they're doing here. Hunter and Clay, how y'all doing?
I'm doing good.
Okay. Oh, Clay's gone. I see that now. Hunter, how are you doing in general with this class? Is it sinking in all
right? I'm right on schedule and like the core schedule, and I'm just getting done with lab 3 right now.
Okay.
So I'm doing pretty well, I like to think.
Good. Yeah. That's right on schedule, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
Good. That's what we stick with that schedule because.
Yeah, that's
getting behind on the schedule will come back to bite you later on in the semester. So stay on top of it now.
Sure.
And did you figure out your question?
This last equation, it will be solved for acceleration.
This one?
Yes. Or will we solve for tension?
It doesn't matter. So those are your two unknowns. You don't know tension and you don't know acceleration. But you have two equations with tension and acceleration. So you solve one of them for one of those unknowns, plug it into the other equation. I would be tempted to solve this one for T. Plug it in up there. And then when you get done with that, that'll be the acceleration. And once you know acceleration, plug it in there, that'll give you tension.
That's what I was.
Okay, good. Good. Okay. Hunter, what questions do you have? You done?
I was just chugging along, yeah.
Okay, sounds good. Anna, do you have another one?
That was good.
Okay. The others have abandoned us, which is okay. I was late, so. Okay, so I think we're done for the day. Hey, Hunter, are you feeling like you're getting ready for the test now?
Yeah, I'm feeling pretty good about it. I'm gonna do a big review session this weekend.
Good plan.
Working up to and throughout the week.
Okay.
Working up to the exam.
Yep. The more questions you do,
yeah,
the better off you'll be. The whole key to this is practice. Just just flat out practice. And then the whole key to practice is just time. It just takes time. So
yeah,
you just gotta invest the time to practice it, practice it, practice it.
Sure.
So.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you.